Hi, this video will cover an efficient FPGA implementation of a multi-cycle integer multiplier for a VR4300 processor. When I originally started working on this component, I thought it would be a simple line of HDL and was not worth a video. I then started to realize that it wasn't so trivial. The MIPS III instruction set defines four multiply operations, which are signed and unsigned versions of 32-bit and 64-bit multiplies. One of the VR4300 manuals lists the operation latency of the 32 and 64-bit multiplies as 3 and 5 cycles, respectively. This is expected since a 64-bit multiply requires more hardware due to twice the number of input bits, and therefore will have longer propagation delays. If you are not familiar with integer multiplier blocks, they are pretty simple. Functionally, they take two input operands of the same size, though they can be different sizes, and output a result which is the sum of the two sizes. So for example here, a 32-bit multiplier accepts two 32-bit inputs and produces a 64-bit output. Note that in this case, the inputs and the outputs can be unsigned or signed to complement numbers, depending on the required function. For a simple example of why the output needs to be twice the size of the inputs, consider the case of an 8-bit multiplier where you want to square the number 255. Here, 255 will fit within the 8-bit quantity. However, the result, 65025, will not, and requires 16 bits. Another thing to note here is that floating point multiplication will, at its core, use an integer multiplier, often taking advantage of a reduced data path, since as you may recall, the single precision mantissa only uses 24 of the 32 bits when the leading one is added. So how are these implemented in hardware? In older and in simpler devices, mainly microcontrollers, multiplication is implemented in software, either by the programmer or via micro operations in the processor. This allows for the processor to utilize existing components, mainly an adder and a shifter, removing the need for a specialized multiplier block. This, however, has a drawback, in that it will require a minimum of the bit width in cycles to complete. So a 32-bit multiply executed via software or microops would require 32 cycles to complete. Newer devices have specialized hardware blocks for performing multiplications. The most typical block is the CSA or carry shift adder, which is arranged in a binary tree. Not only does this specialized hardware perform faster, its tree structure allows for logarithmic complexity computation, which drastically cuts down the propagation delay. This is why the VR4300 required only 3 or 5 cycles to complete an integer multiply as opposed to the otherwise 32 and 64 cycles, respectively. FPGAs also typically use CSA blocks, which are embedded into a larger element called a DSP or digital signal processor block. These blocks are typically statically configured at programming time to perform a single operation, such as multiply, add, rotate, etc., and are never altered by the executing implementation, which poses its own set of problems. The first problem is operating frequency. The VR4300 and the N64 operated at around 95 MHz. And the R5900 and the PlayStation 2 operated at around 295 MHz. The two main devices that I have considered in previous videos are the Altera Cyclone 5E C7 speed device and the Xilinx Arctic 7-1 speed device, having 200 MHz and 190 MHz maximum clock frequencies of their DSP blocks, respectively. These are both fast enough for the VR4300, but neither is fast enough for the PlayStation 2. This isn't exactly a fair comparison though, since the processor here used multiple cycles to complete a multiply. So their multiplier speed would be 1/3 of the listed frequency, and the FPGA speeds listed are for a single cycle multiply. We can see here that both FPGAs would be able to perform the required multiplication in the required time to meet the VR4300's and the R5900's timing requirements. However, actually implementing that within the FPGA is another story. While it may make sense from a hardware perspective to just let the multiplication result be invalid for the first few cycles, allowing for the multiplication to propagate through the CSA block, that won't work for an FPGA synthesizer, which will fail to meet the timing constraints since it has no notion of waiting for a signal to be valid. That adds a little complexity to the problem, since the multiplier needs to be written in a way the synthesizer understands the timing constraints are met. An alternative solution is to pipeline the multipliers. Both Altera and Xilinx have platform-specific pipelined multiplier IPs, which should be inferable from a non-platform-specific HDL description. This means we should be able to write HDL for a pipeline multiplier which can synthesize on both Altera and Xilinx devices. Should is the key word here, since the inference structures are different for the two vendors, which I will discuss a bit later. For now, let's assume that we can write a pipeline version of these DSP multipliers for both devices. If we do that, then the resulting possible fmax increases. Note that both devices are theoretically fast enough to meet the clock frequency of the R5900. Again, the keyword here is theoretically, since the actual implementation is not quite as straightforward. We do, however, have a problem with implementing pipelined multipliers. They are wasteful if we expect a multi-cycle latency. The reason for this is that pipelined multipliers are meant for streaming architectures, so they have a latency of say 3 cycles, but a throughput of 1 multiplication per cycle. Superscalar and pipelined processors, i.e. the R5900 and VR4300, can't make efficient use of such a multiplier, since the subsequent instructions often rely on the multiplier result. This would mean that the processor would only be able to execute one multiply every 3 cycles for a 3-cycle latency multiplier. Out-of-order execution processors, however, could make use of them, but that's not a topic that I'm going to go into. So if we have hardware that can accept one multiply per cycle, but only sends one every 3 cycles, then we are using more resource units than we need, which could be used elsewhere instead, hence wasteful. There might not be much that we can do about that, though. To quickly illustrate why this is an issue, let's consider the number of total DSP blocks in each device. Here I listed the logic elements for the maximum size devices at that speed grade. While there are a lot of multipliers here, these are 18-bit or smaller, meaning that multiple multiplier blocks are needed to even perform a 32-bit multiplication. The next issue to deal with is signed versus unsigned. In a hardware CSA block, you can easily modify some of the input signals to change from signed to unsigned multiplication. Note here that the issue is more of unsigned representation versus 2's complement representation for the multiplication. In an FPGA DSP block, however, a multiplier is configured in one of the 2 modes and does not change. So this means that we either need to duplicate the hardware, one for signed and one for unsigned, or extend the inputs by 1 bit and force signed multiplication. And finally, the last issue is how to deal with 32-bit and 64-bit multiplications. A CSA block can implement a single 64-bit multiplier and tap off the result after the lower 64 bits are computed. The FPGA DSP block, however, cannot do this, since there is no access to the internal signals of the DSP block. So this means that we either need to 1. Duplicate the hardware, again, or 2. Implement a tap ourselves by intercepting the 64-bit value, which can easily be done via factorization. Hopefully you can see that there are several options, which each trade off resource usage and speed. Note that other components of a game console hardware emulator will need to use the DSP blocks as well. So resource usage is something that we want to carefully consider. An example of this is a trilinear or anisotropic filtering block for texture mapping, which the more free DSP blocks you have, the more texture pipelines and therefore a higher quality texture mapping can be done. The first implementation that I tried was the obvious one, where 4 pipeline multipliers were instantiated, each performing one of the 4 multiplication types. Obviously, this is not going to be resource efficient, since for each multiplication, 3 of the hardware units will be unused. It does, however, serve as one of the baselines in which to compare performance and resource utilization. Additionally, 32-bit multipliers were implemented as 3-stage pipelines, and the 64-bit multipliers were implemented as 5-stage pipelines. One of the main reasons why we need a separate unit for signed and unsigned is that the algorithms for performing signed and unsigned multiplication are different, since signed multiplication is done using the 2's complement representation. To consolidate the two, we would either need to find some way to make signed multiplication be unsigned, which can be done by inverting negative numbers and correcting the sign afterwards, but that would require additional clock cycles and more functional units. Alternatively, we could convert the unsigned numbers into signed numbers if we extend the operands by 1 bit. To understand why this works, we have to look at the 2's complement representation. Consider the case of an 8-bit number, or byte. Here, unsigned bytes range from a value of 0, all zeros, to 255, all ones, whereas the signed bytes range from -128, all zeros except for the most significant bit, to 127, all ones except for the most significant bit. This encoding allows for us to easily add signed integers. Additionally, we can easily find out if the signed number is negative by looking at the most significant bit, which is why we can't store a signed positive number larger than 127 in 8 bits. If we extend the field by an extra bit and sign extend the most significant bit for the signed multiplication case, then our new ranges look something like this. You can clearly see that the range of all signed numbers is included in the extension, as well as the original unsigned range, with a maximum value of 255. The only downside is that it might use an additional DSP block for each, depending on their input widths. and that it adds an extra step in the computation, which will also mean additional resources and a slower maximum clock. So let's see how the simple approach does before deciding if it's worth optimizing further. As usual, I am testing the implementation on an Altera Cyclone 5e C7 speed device and an Arctic 7-1 speed device, both of which are readily available in development kits. As with the previous videos, the test implementation is sandwiched between two I/O registers to obtain an estimate for the maximum clock frequency. The same clock is used for those registers as well as the multiplier pipeline. We can clearly see an advantage in resource usage when moving from the signed plus unsigned case to the signed case with the extra bit tacked on. The initial design does decently with the Arctic 7, once again being fast enough to meet the requirements of the N64's VR4300 and the PS2's R5900. The Cyclone 5, on the other hand, is very slow, much slower than I would expect, especially since the Cyclone 5 DSP blocks had a slightly higher frequency than the Arctic 7's. It occurred to me that Cortis, the Altera synthesis tool, was not correctly inferring a pipeline multiplier, and hence why the frequency was so low. It turns out that Altera defines what a pipeline multiplier should look like slightly differently, so maybe that's why the implementation was so slow. Here was the result along with another comparison using no pipeline and a sanity check specifically instantiating an Altera pipeline multiplier IP. Interestingly, the inferred block did slightly better than the explicit IP, but only marginally so. Out of all of these implementations, the most promising one is the first inferred pipeline, since it produces the best result for the Arctic 7, and none of the Cyclone 5 implementations look like they will allow a final R4300 IP to clock at the required 93.75 MHz for the N64. With these results, I still want to try a few other ideas, mainly reusing some hardware and using a type of clock gating instead of a pipeline. The first idea was to use partial products to compute the multiplication instead of two unique pieces of hardware. If we have two 64-bit numbers, F and G, we can represent each as a sum of two 32-bit numbers. So F would be the sum of A and B, G of C and D. Now all we have to do is a little bit of algebra and some distribution of terms to obtain a sum of four products, each of which is of two 32-bit numbers. This notation is a little sloppy to make it easier to see, where the numbers A and C are actually in this form, where they are both multiplied by the value of 1 shifted to the left by 32, which is how the sum of 32-bit products can cover the 128-bit range of the original multiplication. This just means that we need to use 128-bit adders instead of 64-bit ones, but that's a minor problem. Also notice that in this example, the 32-bit multiplication for the mult and multu instructions are in the terms B times D, which is always computed. So since we are using 32-bit multipliers here, the multiplication only needs a latency of 3 cycles, as with the case before, but the sum is a bit more complicated. The easiest solution is to add them in a tree. Additionally, since the propagation time might cause timing issues, and we have 2 extra cycles to spare with a 64-bit multiplication, we can add some pipeline registers. My initial thought was that this implementation was not going to be efficient and will be too resource heavy, but I decided that it should still be done for completeness. Furthermore, this design can be returned to in the future to be optimized further. There is one other idea to consider before doing so, however. My main issue with using a pipelined multiplier is that they allow for one multiplication to complete each cycle, whereas the processor IP will only have a throughput of 1 every 3 cycles at a maximum. So that means that some of the hardware is going to be wasted. Additionally, since we don't need the result for 3 clock cycles, we should be able to run the rest of the processor at a higher clock, with the knowledge that anything output from the multiplier beforehand would be garbage. This is something that can easily be done in silicon, but it is a bit trickier to do in an FPGA, since optimized designs are at the whim of the timing constraint solver. The trick here is to find a way to tell the timing constraint solver that we don't care about the result until after those 3 cycles have passed. Here you can see a timing diagram where the input data is held constant for 3 clock cycles while we wait for the final product R to become available in the following cycle. The arrows here are used to denote that the register latches occur on the rising edge. Now, we could introduce another clock, ideally in this case it would be 1/3 of the main clock frequency, but that would pose synchronization issues. So instead, let's introduce a new clock that is half the frequency of the main clock, which we'll call a gate. The gate clock can be generated via a PLL or just by using a simple clock divider from the main clock. There is one possible problem that can occur here, though, which is alignment of the two clocks. We could potentially have this scenario. Here we introduce the input data on a clock which lies out of phase with the gate clock. Doing so, the product result does not become available until 3 cycles later of the main clock. Luckily, 3 cycles is still within the original intended latency, and therefore, we have a multiplier that will sometimes complete in 2 cycles and sometimes in 3. However, for simplicity, the control logic can just assume 3 cycles for all cases. Hopefully this makes sense. When I first attempted this implementation, I wasn't sure if it would help or even work in the first place. Which on that note, let's see how the new methods do when compared to the previous implementations. The first row here is the best inferred pipeline from the previous table, which is kept for comparison. Each idea was combined one at a time and then finally together to see if there was a performance improvement. Interestingly, even though the partial product version contains more multiplier blocks than the duplicated hardware, it ends up using fewer DSPs on the Arctic 7. There was one more option that could still be done, which was to reduce the size of the adders in the partial product implementations. The first stage of the pipeline only needs to use 96-bit adders instead of 128-bit ones. This means fewer resources could be used. The results here were a bit surprising, with the additional architecture changes being more efficient for the Cyclone 5 and the original inferred pipeline being more efficient for the Arctic 7. If I were to choose an implementation to use for both target devices, I would go with the partial product optimization. However, if we decide to instead alter the architecture depending on the target device, which is different from instantiating device-specific IPs, since both versions will compile and synthesize on both platforms, then I would choose the gated plus partial opt for the Cyclone 5 and the original inferred pipeline for the Arctic 7. Most likely, the reason for the initial implementations being so slow on the Cyclone 5e was due to the 64-bit multipliers being large and having huge propagation delays. We can see that the speeds effectively doubled when we moved away from the pipeline 64-bit multipliers. It's possible that there is a more efficient multiplier implementation for this specific use case. However, I am satisfied with the chosen implementation since they have high enough performance for a R4300 and the Arctic 7 should be able to meet the speed requirements of the R5900, though I believe the R5900 also had a 128-bit multiplier, which would complicate things a bit more. In the end, the DSP block utilization ended up being insignificant, but it was still nice to reduce the usage in half by combining signed and unsigned multiplication. Anyway, this was one of the first components that I created for this project, thinking it would be simple. This just goes to show that even the simplest component can benefit from a little optimization. Hopefully you found this interesting. Thanks for watching.